Our scripture reading this morning is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 10, verses 10 and 11. Then I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became bitter. And he said to me, "You must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, tongues, and kings."
Satisfy. Jesus was merciful, merciful to me.
You see, I have the scars to prove that I've taken this one's place. Merciful to me when I deserve to die. Merciful to me, my soul he brought to life. Nothing could I bring, I yet to satisfy. Jesus was
Morning. Happy Sabbath. I'm going to start down here if that's okay. This sermon could have easily been called Jane Made Me Do It. And the reason I say that is because the sermon that you're getting today was actually the first lecture that we gave in this evangelism series that we're giving on Wednesday nights as part of our prayer meeting. And she said, you know what, the whole church needs to hear this. And so I said, okay, Jane, if I get an opportunity, that's what I'll present. So here I am. Now, the second part of that, Jane told me this past Wednesday, after we did a lecture on how to give your personal testimony, she said, you need to give your personal testimony. So Jane made me do it. So let me start. There is no better place than talking about what Christ has done in our own lives. Now, I'm going to get emotional, I'll tell you. It's hard not to. He has grabbed my heartstrings. And so Revelation 12 actually says that we shall overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. So here is mine. I am a servant of the God Most High. I haven't always been. As a matter of fact, I was raised up and born into a secular family who never talked about God. I was raised up in an area right outside of an Adventist community in Collegedale, Tennessee. Had Adventist friends, knew Adventist families, and was never once invited to an Adventist church. But the Lord blessed me, and He allowed me to be married eventually to an Adventist woman who brought me to an Adventist church after we had been arguing, thinking that the Lord was the only thing that could heal our marriage, and boy, was she right. Took me to an Adventist church, and I began Bible studies with one of the elders. And it wasn't long before I was baptized. But let me tell you, I didn't know the first thing about the Bible when I came into the church. I was someone who spent my Saturdays drinking beer and smoking cigarettes in a local pub watching football. Okay, I didn't know the first thing about it. I was the chief of sinners, as Paul would say. And so even then, as I was studying the Word, it was still difficult for me to fully grasp what God has done for me. And so when troubles came, and they always come, don't they, when you start to seek God in His Word, when the troubles came, my house was not built upon the rock. and it crashed. My marriage ended horribly. We divorced, went our separate ways. I went to Hawaii, she moved to Georgia. We did not speak unless it was angry, had angry tones toward each other. My children were victimized by it. I became a man so obsessed with my own anger that I couldn't even see the light of day. In the military, I was given plenty of opportunities, and I wanted to take them to go overseas and fight against the enemies of this nation. And let me tell you, somewhere deep inside of me, looking back now, I just wanted to die. I wanted to be in that environment so that the Lord would just take me out of this pain that I had. I blamed him. But he blessed me with Lou. Amen. And so let me tell you how this works. Even with Lou, who was going to a Sunday church, Sunday keeping church, she tried to get me to go to church with her on numerous times, but I was so angry that I just did not want it. I always used every excuse, a football game that I wanted to see, I had a college paper due, anything that I could to get out of going. And then one day she invited me, and I was sitting in bed. I remember the day. I was sitting in bed doing this paper, and she comes in. She says, "Zach, come on, come with me today." And I was about to say no, and it was as if I heard a voice say, "Have you not looked around? Do you not know where you are?" So I said, "Wait a minute, I'm getting ready." So I went with her, and we attended this church here in town, here in Fredericksburg. And after it, I'll just tell you, it was very similar to being in the world. I felt like I'd just been to a rock concert. So it wasn't a big shocker to me. And afterward, I came to Lou and I said, "You know, Lou, I don't know what it is. I've felt a little bit uncomfortable with it. But let me tell you, I think the chief thing I'm uncomfortable with is when I started to study the Bible years ago, God showed me some of his truths that I didn't see practiced here. One of those is I think we're actually going to church on the wrong day." So he was already speaking to me. And so she had never even heard the word Sabbath. She didn't even know what it was. To her, it was, if you ask her now, she'll tell you it was something weird. And so what did we do? We got in God's word and we started researching about God's commandments and his Sabbath and how beautiful it is. And before you knew it, I became addicted. Some nights I was laying in bed till 1 o'clock in the morning, knowing I had to get up at 5 a.m. to go to work. And I couldn't close God's word. She found me at times awkwardly, crying and laughing at the same time because he showed me something so beautiful. And so, in this discovery of God's commandments and his law and his Sabbath, we came across the verse in Ecclesiastes that says, the whole duty of man is to keep the commandments of God. And so we end up going to her church one last Sunday. And I say last Sunday because of this. As we sat down in the pews, the preacher was notorious for preaching on one or two verses of the Bible and nothing else. So you'd get one or two. And the one verse he gave us this day was that verse from Ecclesiastes. She and I looked at each other, smiled. The very next Sabbath, we were in a Seventh-day Adventist church. So let me tell you, my story doesn't end there. My story is a story of how God can take what I have destroyed and wrecked, and he can make it perfect again. Amen. And so what God did, now here's where I'm going to get emotional, so I'm going to grab my napkin here. So one day I'm driving down the road, and I'm listening to a sermon, and I had to pull off the side of the road because it was so powerful. It was about Elijah and Elisha. And so I ended up praying, saying, "Lord, that's double helping of the spirit that you gave to Elisha. I want a double helping of that spirit, Lord." And on the way home, I got what I asked for. The spirit told me, "You need to call your ex-wife, who I haven't spoken to in a long time." So she now lives outside of Collegedale still in Dalton, Georgia. And I called her, and I said, "Janet, this is Zach. I don't know how to tell you this, but I just felt impressed to call you. And I want to do something that I never did while we were married. I want to pray for you. So here is what God did by me being obedient to his command. She started weeping on the phone. Within 2 weeks, she herself, who had been angry and living out in the world, was back in an Adventist church. She had been remarried to a Pentecostal man, and now he is in the Adventist church. Our children who had left the church, one of them is back in the Adventist church, and one is still working on her heart. You see, did I tell you that my story is a story of how God can make perfect all the things that I've wrecked? That's why I praise him. And I wanted to share that with you to open. It's all Jane's fault, though. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this opportunity. Lord, I now ask that you anoint my lips, that these people see none of me, but feel your presence and hear your words of life. In Jesus' name, amen. The promise of a father. It had been months, and Major John, who was a major in the Marine Corps, and I have some Marines in the audience here who can relate to this story. They've all experienced this. He knew that he was being deployed overseas, and he had dreaded it because he knew the morning that he would have to get on that plane and fly off to Afghanistan, he would have to go and confront his wife and his children one last time, and it's very difficult. So for months he's dreaded it. Now the morning comes. He's in the kitchen and he's embracing his wife. And he realizes that it's time that he has to go and tell little John Jr., give him one last hug, and then depart for the plane. He goes into and starts to go down the hallway to the room, and he can already hear the muffled cries of John inside of his room, which makes it very difficult because he loves him so much. He walks to the room, he lightly knocks on the door, and he opens it, and there is John still laying in bed with the blankets up over his head. He sits down next to him, and he pulls the blankets back, and he says, John, listen, I know this is difficult, but I have to go. I have to go because I love you, and I love your family, and I must defend everything that we believe in. And John, in his muffled little cry, says, but Father, I'm going to miss you so much. I don't know what I'll do without you here every day. How will I know when you'll come back? Not really knowing the answer to this, he walks over to John's window and he starts to gaze out. As he's gazing out, it comes to him. He says, John, come here. Come stand beside me. And as they gaze out the window together, he says, do you see the leaves on those trees? When those leaves turn brown and they fall off and they're on the ground, know that the time is near. Now let me ask you, friends. Every day, John went outside to play. The leaves are green. He goes and plays with his friends. He goes to school. Things just like normal happen. But one night, while he's asleep, a brisk fall storm comes in, and the leaves had just started to change. And when he woke up that morning and he looked out of his window as he did every morning, the leaves had fallen off the trees and had landed on the ground. What do you think his reaction was? My father is coming. My father is coming. You see, he loved his father so much that he was excited for the day that he lived in, for he knew that it was close. And he ran outside and told everybody in the street, even the mailman who didn't even know his father, that the time draws near and he is coming soon. We have a God that reveals himself to us and gives us the mile markers along the road. Now let me tell you, friends, many in this church use prophecy as the destination. Jesus is our destination. The prophecy is the mile marker so that we know where we are along the journey. We're going to talk about that today a little bit. There are two verses shown here right now. One is Amos 3:7, and it says that surely the Lord God will do nothing but he reveals his secret unto his servants, the prophets. Now that's in a negative. He will do nothing. If I put that in the positive, it says that God will reveal all things through his servants, the prophets. There is nothing he will not show. He has revealed everything. There are tenths of mile markers on this journey, friends. If you use a nautical term, you know, we use the term in the Navy called dead reckoning. If you're using one point on a map to navigate by, you might end up dead because it's not very safe to navigate with one point on the map. But if you had three or more, it was very safe. God has given us thousands. We can know precisely where we are. So he reveals all things. In Isaiah 42:9, it reveals something different about prophecy. There are tons that talk about prophecy. I chose these two because these two show something very significant. One says what? All things. The second says when? Before they happen. So not only does God reveal all things, he reveals them to us before they ever occur, so that we can know precisely where we are and we can have faith that he is the destination. Did Jesus think it was important for us to listen to the prophets? Then he said unto them, O fools, slow of heart, to believe all, hear that word? All that the prophets have spoken. So if Jesus thought it was foolish to not believe all that the prophets have spoken, why? What is the result of not knowing or loving God's truth? What is the result of ignoring what the prophets have said? Hosea 4:6. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee. That thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing that thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. So notice how this verse starts. My people. This is not talking about those out there who do not know him. This is talking about his people rejecting knowledge. Another verse in the New Testament talks about this in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish because they receive not the love of the truth that they might be saved. The love of the truth that they might be saved. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, and that they all might be damned who believe not the truth but have pleasure in unrighteousness. Now notice here it couples a couple of things. It says, deceivableness and unrighteousness in them that perish. That thought is co-joined with the thought of them that receive not the love of the truth. The truth brings us to righteousness. John 17:17. We all know that verse, right? Sanctify them with thy truth. Thy word is truth. I'll give you some truth here. What is at the center of all prophecy? I'm going to go up here so I can get my Bible. And I want you guys to look, and please open your Bibles. You know, I'm going to tell you something. We're people of the Word. And we have to get used to opening God's Word and looking through it and knowing where these pages and these verses are. Let me say something to you. Out in the world, and here we live in Virginia and wine country, you'll find people that love to go to wine tastings. And they'll go and they'll take wine and they'll look at it in a glass and they'll look at the color and how sticky it is on the side of the glass. I don't know that exact term. And then they'll take a sip of it and they'll swash it around in their mouth. They'll savor every element of it. This is what we are to do with God's Word. Every single word in God's Word has a purpose. So let's savor God's Word together. Now notice here in Psalm 40, verse 7, and let's turn there first, please. Psalm 40 and verse 7. Then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book it is written of me. Many of us know that Psalm is a book of prophecy. As David was impressed by the Holy Spirit to write Psalm 40, he's going through and he's writing all these beautiful words about waiting patiently for the Lord, verse 1. How the Lord has brought him out of a horrible pit, verse 2. And has set his feet, has established him upon the rock. Who is that rock, friends? Jesus. He's established his feet upon the rock. And he has put a new song in his mouth, even praise unto God, verse 3. And he's blessed is the man that maketh the Lord his trust and respecteth not the proud, verse 4. Verse 5, many, O Lord my God, are thy wonderful works. Is that not true? Now, verse 6, something happens. It's as if God says, hold on, David. It's time for me to talk. I want to speak directly to my people. And he says these words, sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. Notice the term, mine ears hast thou opened. Now, it doesn't take a whole lot. Those of us who know where the Ten Commandments are in Exodus 20, have you ever read Exodus 21? Turn with me now real quick to Exodus 21. I want you to look at something. Starting at verse 1, now these are the judgments which thou... Now remember, God has just completed the Ten Commandments, giving the Ten Commandments. Now these are the judgments which thou shalt set before them. If thou buy any Hebrew servant, 6 years he shall serve, and in the seventh he shall go out free for nothing. So in the seventh year, they're set free. If he came in by himself, he shall go out by himself. If he were married when his... then his wife shall go out with him. So if you were married and you came into this bondage, you were able to go out with your wife. No issue. But if the master, verse 4, have given him a wife, and she have borne him sons and daughters, the wife and her children shall be her master's, and he shall go out by himself. And if that servant shall plainly say, I love my master, my wife, and my children, I will go not out free. Then his master shall bring him unto the judges, and he shall also bring him to the door. Now, who is the door? Yeah, right? He shall bring him to the door, or unto the doorpost, and his master shall bore his ear through with an awl, and he shall serve him forever. Now, notice here, when we're reading Psalm 40, it says, my ear hast thou pierced. You see, a man could sell himself into this bondage willingly because he loved the master. He could sell himself willingly into this bondage because he loved his bride. And here, the voice of God says, I am a willing servant. My ear have you pierced. I love my bride. I love my God. I love the children that thou hast given me. Then said I, lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me. Jesus said, quiet, David. I want to speak. In the story, on the road to Emmaus, Jesus appears to two of the disciples that were upset over the fact that things didn't go precisely the way they thought they were going to go. And Jesus, beginning at Moses and all the prophets, expounded unto them all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. You see, Jesus is the center of all the prophets, of all the law, and the Psalms, I'll add. And I fell at his feet, Revelation 19:10, to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not, I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So friends, let's talk about that spirit of prophecy a little bit. God reveals himself to us in a particular way. When I was at AFCO training, Amazing Facts Center of Evangelism, we did an exercise where we started looking at certain verses of prophecy and something became apparent. And I'm going to share that with you right now. You see, God first raises up a prophet and delivers a message that is not of present truth. So he'll raise up a prophet and he'll declare to him a truth that is many, many mile markers down the road, not of his lifetime. Later, he gives a message to a prophet to declare present truth fulfillment and that a judgment is at hand. Something is going to be judged. And then out of this judgment, he always refines a people and delivers a remnant. Let me say it again. He always refines his people and delivers a remnant. This is good news, folks. Now, I'm going to show you on this chart up here precisely what I'm talking about. Turn, if you would, to the book of Jude. Did you guys know that Enoch was a prophet? Yeah? Yeah, Enoch was a prophet. If you look at these verses in Jude, you see so. Jude is the book right before Revelation. Jude, verse 14 and 15, it says, "And Enoch, also the seventh from Adam," don't let that escape either, that's kind of neat, that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, was translated to be with God. "The seventh from Adam prophesied of these sayings, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have ungodly committed, and all of their hard speeches, which ungodly sinners have spoken against him." So here, Jude is shown to be not only a prophet, but a preacher of righteousness, convicting people of their sin, which means that they would have to repent. Now, how about this other one, Genesis 5:21? This is, you know, Enoch is only spoken of in a few places in the Bible. Genesis 5:21 is the other. Now, everyone knows that Enoch essentially was the grandfather of Noah, right? Now, or great-grandfather. And so, if you look at 5:21, Genesis 5:21. If I can get my fingers there. Here we go. It says, "And Enoch lived 65 years and begat Methuselah." This is the prophecy that we're discussing here that is not present truth. Does everyone see the prophecy there? No? We've talked about it at our studies. There is a prophecy buried here. Methuselah in Hebrew means, when he dies, it shall come. When he dies, it shall come. So, in naming his own son, he was prophesying of the day that the flood would pour out upon the earth. Now, so here you have the event. Enoch giving something of not present truth, he would not live to see it, would give an event that God wanted us to know about. It was significant. Now, he also raised up a prophet to declare judgment has come. Now, let's look at Genesis 6, verses 12 and 13. Just a couple pages over. "And God looked upon the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted its way upon the earth. And God said to Noah, The end of all flesh is come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth." So here, Noah has raised up a prophet to give a present truth message that the hour of judgment has come. The earth has turned wicked and destruction is coming upon them. But we also find that in 2 Peter chapter 2 that Noah was a preacher of righteousness, which means that God sent Noah forth to declare to all people his salvation. Noah's family of eight were not to be the only ones that were to get upon the ark. It just so happened that everyone else rejected the truth. So God raises up a prophet, declares a truth not of present time, declares an event, and he declares to another prophet that he raises up a present truth and a present judgment, and he delivers a remnant. Those who listened, Noah's sons and wives and himself at this point. How about Abraham? In Genesis 15, 13, Abraham is shown that the children of Israel will go into bondage in Egypt for 400 years. Turn to that verse, Genesis 15, 13. So this is a message, not present truth. Abraham himself would not live to go into bondage in Egypt. But the children of Israel, the children of his descendancy, did go into bondage for 400 years. Genesis 15, 13 says, "And he said unto Abraham, Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them for 400 years." Abraham was given a prophecy. Let's see if we get that. There we go. And at the time of present truth, God raises up a prophet to declare that the present truth is here and judgment has come. Turn now to Exodus 3, verses 8 and 10. "And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them out of the land unto a good land, and a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt." So God raised up Abraham, gave him a vision that the 400 years of captivity, now the time has come. God raises up a prophet and says, "Moses, go to Pharaoh and prophesy to him. Tell him to let my people go." Judgment fell upon Egypt. Now let me ask you a question. Who was Egypt at that time? Was there an Israeli nation at that time? No. All of Egypt included the children of Israel as slaves. Notice when the last of the, when the angel of death descended upon Israel that night, upon Egypt that night, that the children of Israel were instructed to do something that offered them salvation. Otherwise, they would have perished. The firstborn would have perished along with all the other citizens of Egypt. They had to go and put the blood of the lamb that they had slain upon the doorpost. So had they not done that, they would have perished. The firstborn would have perished with every citizen of Egypt. But because of these things, God delivers a remnant, and out of the nation of Egypt comes a nation of Israel, a remnant. A remnant that existed because they were covered by the blood of the Lamb. Now, God wastes no time, does he? He marches them right to the Red Sea for baptism. Jeremiah. In this verse in 25:11, Jeremiah is shown that the king of Babylon will march upon Jerusalem and Jerusalem will fall, and that it will lead to 70 years of captivity for the children of Israel inside of Babylon. So here Jeremiah is seeing something that is not of present truth, it's for a time far off. He gives an event that God wants us to know about, but at the time when the 70 years has expired, the time is complete, God raises up a prophet to declare present truth and judgment. Turn with me to this verse, these verses here in Daniel chapter 5. So here, the nation of Babylon had been in utter control and dominion of the children of Israel. Daniel himself and his friends had been marched out from Jerusalem, Yerushalem, God's peace, and into Babylon, which means confusion. So here in this city of Babylon, just to set the background, the current king of Babylon, Belshazzar, directs that his servants go in to the treasury and remove the vessels that came out of the temple in Jerusalem that he removed from there when his father removed from there when it fell. He asked that they be brought to him. He asked that they be filled with the wine of Babylon. And he drinks from the holy vessels the wine of Babylon. Now, a bloodless hand comes in and he writes some writing on the wall. And Daniel is called forth to come and explain what the writing means. And in verse 25, it says, "And this is the writing that was written, Mene, Mene, Tikal, Upharsin. This is the interpretation of the thing. Mene, God has numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tikal, thou art weighed in the balances and are found wanting. Peres, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Judgment. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. In that night, in that very night, folks, Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, was slain. Judgment had come." Let me explain something to you as well that's jumped out at me when I was reading these verses in preparation. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, it talks about the fact that you, that I, are holy vessels unto the Lord. Vessels, friends, are made to contain something. They're made to contain something. We have two choices as to what our vessels contain. They can either contain the Holy Spirit. Do you not know that you're the temple of the Holy Spirit? Your vessel can contain the Holy Spirit, or it can contain the wine of Babylon. But let me tell you what happens when you choose Babylon. You will be weighed in the balances and found wanting. We must choose to be vessels of the Holy Spirit. Daniel was even given a specific vision of the first advent of Christ. You can see this in Daniel 9, verses 24 through 27. Because we're getting pretty short on time, I'm going to try to burn through some of these. But in this vision... Daniel 9, 24 through 27. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon the holy city to finish the transgression and to make an end of sins and make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and the prophecy and to anoint the most holy. Notice those words, anoint the most holy. So Daniel was given a sign of something that wouldn't happen for 70 weeks. Now, we know that there are many verses in the Bible that teach us that we are to use a day for a year in prophecy. If I can get my notes here working. I wanted to share a couple of them with you. One of them I would like to talk about is Numbers 14:34, which talks about the fact that there would be 49 years, and then a year that would come after it would be known as a jubilee. So 49 is 7 times 7. So 49 years, and then the year that would come after that would be a rest into the land. It would be a time when all things that have been bound up would be set free. You'd be loosed. It would be a time of rejoicing. Now notice here in this prophecy of Daniel chapter 9 that there are 10 jubilee periods until the time of the real Jubilee. The good news, the gospel himself, Jesus Christ would come after the 69 weeks. So Daniel did not live 483 years to see this. It was a prophecy not of his time. It was a prophecy not of present truth. But God did raise up a prophet to declare that the hour of judgment is come, that the present truth is here. Turn with me to Matthew 3, 1 through 14. We're not going to read all these verses just due to time. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." For this is what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." Now later on in verse 7 he says, "But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his baptism, he said to them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come?" He's talking about the judgment. "Bring forth therefore fruits, meat of repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, we have Abraham to our father. For I say unto you that God is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees." This is a specific comment of the judgment that would come to the nation of Israel that would reject the Messiah. They would not recognize the time of their visitation. "Therefore, every tree which bringeth forth not good fruit is hewn down and cast into fire. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire." Now, when Jesus appears, you find in one of the other Gospels, when Jesus appears, what does John the Baptist declare? "Behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world." You see, he is declaring a present judgment and a present truth. Now, turn real quick to Mark 1:15. I want to show you something that is just completely amazing. What did Jesus think about this expiration of time prophecy? Mark chapter 1 and verse 15. Now, notice that from 12, you see that that Jesus had come up out of the water, the Spirit had descended upon him, he had gone up into the wilderness. Now Jesus comes out of the wilderness in verse 13. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beast, and the angels ministered unto him. Verse 14, "Now after that, John was put in prison. Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God." So he's baptized, he goes into the wilderness, he comes back out of the wilderness, John is in prison, and here's what Jesus has to say. "The time is fulfilled." What time is Jesus talking about? He's talking about Daniel 9, 24 through 27. The time is fulfilled. You see, it said until the Messiah. When Jesus was baptized, he was anointed. What does the Messiah mean in Hebrew? The anointed one. So Jesus was declaring that the time is fulfilled. Amen? So are you seeing a trend? Not a present truth. An event will happen. Before the event happens, God reveals through his servants, the prophets, that something is happening, that the hour of judgment has come. Now, if we're seeing this trend all the way through the Bible, what about the 2300 days prophecy of Daniel 8:14? Remember, a day for a year. Daniel 8:14 says that after 2,300 days, the sanctuary shall be cleansed. Another word there for cleanse is could be recovered, could be rediscovered. You can insert a couple words also that have similar meaning. Restored. But we know that in 457 BC, which was the command to go forth and rebuild Jerusalem, given by Artaxerxes, which can be found in Ezra 7:7, that the 2,300 days would begin at that time. Now, if you count 2,300 years into the future, you land at 1844. Something miraculous was about to happen to the world in 1844. So if God gave a prophecy to Daniel, a prophet, something that wasn't of his current time. He gave this prophecy of an event that would not happen in his life. Shouldn't there be a prophet raised up to declare the hour of judgment has come? God did raise up such a prophet. Revelation 10 gives us a picture of the unfolding of this. And God delivers a remnant. He delivers a church with a special message for their special time in history. Now, we're going to talk really quickly about Revelation 10, because I have to wrap this up pretty soon. We're already over. Revelation 10, in order to fully understand it, you have to start in Revelation 9. Now, just to make up time here, Revelation 9, verse 1. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth. And to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. Well, actually, you know what? I'm going to jump right to the sixth trumpet. So here, in Revelation 9, you have the sixth trumpet. In Revelation 11, you have the seventh trumpet. There's something in between Revelation 10. The sixth trumpet takes place in one area of the sanctuary. The last trumpet takes place in another. Now, let's go to verse 13. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God. Now, where is this altar with the four horns? It is in the holy place. It is not in the most holy place. It is in the holy place. As a matter of fact, the priest here in this photograph is standing before it. And notice the veil of that separates between the most holy place. So here in Revelation 9, as the sixth trumpet sounds, you have a scene of being in the holy place. Now, let's go to Revelation 11. And let's go to verse 19. Now remember, we're talking about Revelation 10, which is in between. Now, Revelation 11, verse 19, and the temple of God was opened in heaven, and there was seen in the temple the ark of his testament, and there were lightnings and voices and thunderings and earthquake and great hail. So, in chapter 9, we're in the holy place. By chapter 11, we're in a different apartment altogether. We're in the apartment with the ark of the covenant and the law of God. Chapter 10, there's a shift. Something occurs. Now let's turn to 10. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and the rainbow was upon his head, and the face was, it were, the sun, and feet as pillars of fire. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea, and his left foot upon the earth, which means the whole world. This is for the whole world. Sea and earth, the entire world. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot upon the earth. And he cried with a loud voice as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. We'll talk about that in a future sermon, if you want. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth, lifted up his hand to heaven, and he swore by him that liveth forever and ever, and who created the heaven and the things that are therein, and the earth and the things that are therein, and the sea and the things that are therein, that time should be no longer. So you hear that? The Creator who created the earth, the heavens, the earth, and the sea. Do we hear this language somewhere else in Revelation? Revelation 14, 6 and 7, right? So this is for the entire world, and he's giving glory to the Creator who created all these things, the heaven, the earth, and the sea, and all things that are therein. But he declares something interesting here, that time should be no longer. Now, we learned earlier that when the expiration of the time occurred for the 490 days, the 70 weeks prophecy of Daniel, Jesus, after his anointing, his baptism, declared the time is complete. Here, the 2,300 days expired, and God declares, time shall be no longer. See, the 2,300 days went the furthest into the future. There are no more time prophecies. Time shall be no longer. And the voice I heard from heaven spake unto me again and said, go and take the little book which is opened in the hand of the angel which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went to the angel and said unto him, give me the little book. And he said unto me, take it and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. All right, real quick. The little book. Daniel is known as the little book of prophecy. Daniel 12, verse 4. Daniel is commanded to seal up the prophecy until the time of the end when men will be running to and fro and knowledge shall be increased. Friends, if we look at the understanding of Daniel, no one really understood it or even wrote about it until the year 1841, 1842. And by 1844, you had a massive movement that was happening globally. In America, only 500,000 people joined the church in 2 years. Which would be an equivalency, as I said here in church one other day. If we were to do that today, we'd be preaching to 8,000 people this Sabbath. Daniel spread like wildfire. Something was happening. And when they understood Daniel, they misunderstood what was happening. A little farmer turned minister named William Miller went out, and he is the one who really started the fire here in America. They went out and they had tent meetings and camp meetings and spread the gospel. A beautiful story that Jesus is returning on October 22nd, 1844. They consumed Daniel. Take the little book and eat it. They consumed it. And it must have been sweet as honey, friends. Can you imagine, as we sang that song earlier today, lo, he comes. Yes, Jesus comes. How it must have felt knowing that in just a few days we're going to meet our Lord, our Creator, our Redeemer. Can you imagine that? Probably should, because we're 170 years closer today. Lo, he comes. Now, the problem is, he didn't come, did he? So this book that must have tasted sweet as honey became bitter in their stomach. They consumed it and it instantly became bitter. But look at what God does. In verse 11, at the height of the bitterness, after they had eaten it and my belly was bitter, in verse 11, and he said unto me, thou must prophesy again. Thou must prophesy again. You see, friends, you and I live today in a church that is a prophetic movement. We were prophesied to come out of great tribulation. Now, does God lead his people into tribulation? I tell you, he does. We found out on the road to Emmaus that there were two disciples that were upset because he didn't come as the conquering king and establish the throne in the seat of David. Jesus himself commanded them to go and find the donkey that he might enter into Jerusalem thereon, which was a symbol of him being the conquering Messiah. You see, God leads us through these times to establish people of true and real faith. Friends, he has established this movement for us to be a people of real and true faith, a prophetic people with a prophetic message. We should not be cowering. We should be declaring that the hour of judgment has come. Amen. Now, I'm going to skip the slide about the three angels. Unfortunately, it is such a beautiful lesson, but you know, sometime in the future, hopefully we can talk about this. Or if you just want to know, Friday night Bible studies at my house, we talk about some of these things. But I do want to talk real quickly about the parable of the vineyard, and then I'm going to close. In the parable of the vineyard in Matthew 20, Jesus says that there's a landowner who has a vineyard. He gets up early, he goes out, and he finds workers. He finds these workers, he brings them back, he makes a covenant with them, and then sends them into his vineyard to work. 3 hours later, he goes out and he finds other workers. He brings them back, and he puts them to work. 3 hours after that, he goes out and he finds other workers and he brings them back. 3 hours after that, he finds other workers and he brings them back. Then we see something different. You see the trend? Every 3 hours, he's sending someone out to go and work. This is a vineyard owner who has some anxiety about something that's coming up soon. And let me tell you, we live here in wine country. If you go and ask any vineyard owner when it is season, harvest season for these grapes, what would make you anxious to want to get that harvest in? And they will all tell you, a storm is coming. You see, when the low pressure rolls in, the pressure within the grape exceeds the pressure that is without the grape, and they burst, and the harvest is no good. You see, our God knows a storm is coming, friends. And he wants us to each be workers in his vineyard and to bring in the harvest before the storms come. So what does he do? He doesn't wait 3 hours. He sends out an 11th hour church with a message to fear God and give glory to him. For the hour of his judgment is come. And worship him who created the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. He has an 11th hour church. Now I want to talk to you in closing about Gettysburg. At Gettysburg, two massive armies, one from the Union, one from the Confederacy, met by accident on a battlefield. This battlefield was a completely gory incident, horrific devastation. They charged at the Union left and were not able to break through. The Union had dug in across a series of hills and they were not going to give up the ground. Confederacy tried the right flank, the right side, and were not able to break through. And then came that fateful third day. Orders General Pickett to charge across an open field under heavy cannon and musket fire and try to take the center of the Union Army, thinking that they had reinforced the flanks, but they hadn't. They had reinforced the center. So all of these men, led by a man named General Low Armstead, who happened to be friends, best friends actually, with the general who was behind the Union wall, General Hancock. He was ordered to take his troops across this field, cross the fence, cross the open field with heavy cannon fire and heavy musket, and history records that it was horrendous. Pickett's failed charge. But did you know that Low Armstead and a few of his troops actually made it to the wall? Low Armstead leaped up upon the wall trying to wave his troops across and was mortally shot 3 times. As he fell down behind the wall, he asked the troops around him, whose troops are you? Who do you belong to? And the Union troops looked at him and said, sir, we're the troops of General Hancock. He said, my good friend, would you please ask him to come forward as he could and give him my most prized possession? And he pulls out a bloodied Bible. Take this and have him give it to my wife when they meet again. You can't write stories like this. Friends, it was such a bloody day, that third day, that bodies were strewn everywhere. Tens of thousands of men lay bloodied, bleeding and dying on the field. The Union troops would not go down into the field to collect their wounded because they were afraid of a Confederate counterattack. The Confederates were not going into the field to gather their wounded because they were preparing to retreat under the cover of night. So the wounded lay there bleeding and in pain. And the screams of agony, it is recorded in history, were horrific. Men in dire pain, thirsty in the summer battlefields, and darkness started to fall. It is recorded that there was one anomalous event, one strange thing that occurred. In the midst of all of this pain, one lone Mennonite farmer was seen walking the battlefield with a light, looking for his son. He would look down amongst the bodies, and then he would raise the light, and he would cry out, James Carter, James Carter, thy father seeketh thou. Thy father seeketh thou. And he would go about looking again. He would continue this for a while. But his son couldn't hear him because of the cries of people on the battlefield. So he would raise his light again. James Carter, thy father seeketh thou. But men were still writhing and crying out in pain. Something strange began to happen. One man, hearing the cry and being moved in his heart for this father, raises up and he says, James Carter, your father is seeking you. And as the old man continued to look, the cries started to spread. James Carter, thy father is seeking you. And more. And before you knew it, it was recorded that the echoes of James Carter, thy father seeketh thou, were going throughout the valley. Men were giving up on their own pain to help the father seek his lost children. So the father, after a while, hears a voice. Father, father, here I am. And he raced over and he picks his lost child up and he nurses, takes him home and he nurses him back to health. Friends, that was the bloodiest war that we have ever seen as a nation. Let me tell you of another civil war. A civil war that started in heaven and has come down to earth. We are living in the battleground of this civil war. Every one of us has been injured by it. If you look at your neighbor, you can't see the scars. They're around their hearts. We have each been wounded. Our God has been wounded in this war. We have a choice before us. Do we continue to writhe in agony on the battlefield? Or do we accept our Father's healing? Do we pick up His great light and help Him shine forth upon His lost children and find them? This is the decision before you and I today. Now, friends, if today God has touched your heart, if His Holy Spirit has said, you've heard His voice say, my child, you are wounded and I want to make you whole. If you have heard His voice say, my child, I want you to help me find my lost children. I ask you now, as we prepare to sing this song, we're going to do an old-fashioned altar call. Come forward and declare to the Lord your God that I am prepared, Lord, for your healing, that I want to join your army looking for your lost children. So we're going to sing the first four verses. Come on up. We'll pray and we'll sing the last two.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to God, I come.
Dearest Lord, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit and for the gift of your Son. Lord, we have felt your presence today. We know that we are in a battlefield and your lost children are scattered about. Empower us, O Lord, as a church to be able to reach them, to show them the light of your love and your mercy, and to bring them home to you. We consecrate ourselves this day to your work in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Just as I am, poor wretched, blind, sight riches he.
Thank you for today, and we ask your blessing upon each of us, each family represented here, and those who could not be. As we go our way this week, we ask, dear Lord, that you lead someone to us that needs your healing. Then, Lord, that we would be always looking for those who need to know of your love. Father, make us instruments. Fill us up with your Spirit, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You now may be seated.